Hello, folks. This is Amner Hunter from Amner Hunter Studios, your host, and I'm really happy to be sharing the part two of the mixing tutorials that I just started like 1 week or 1 week and a half ago. So if you didn't check out the first video of this mixing topics, I recommend you to check it out because it's really important. I touch a lot of information, a lot of background information and theory about sound and frequencies that will help you a lot. So if you didn't check out the video, go check it out here. I will put the link right here. And this time around, we are going to be this studying a topic called patterns of frequency distribution. So having considered in general the psychological effects of individual frequencies and combinations of frequencies, now we can examine the specific frequency distribution patterns of common sounds. Obviously, it would be impossible to describe the frequency distribution patterns of every possible sound that we listen to. Indeed, every frequency distribution describes one sound or another. So in this section, we only will simply examine the frequency distribution patterns of the sound, of the sounds most commonly found in music. We will only examine four categories of sounds, but they cover a very, very large amount of ground. With them, we will be able to account for the majority of sounds found in most of music. So the first pattern of frequency distribution is the tones. The tone is the simplest frequency organization structure is the tone. Tones are very common in nature, and our brains are specially built to perceive them. A tone is a series of frequencies arranged in a particular, mathematically simple pattern. The lowest frequency in the tone is the fundamental. It's called fundamental, and the frequencies above it are called harmonics. The first harmonic is twice the frequency of the fundamental. The second harmonic is three times the frequency, and so forth. This extension could theoretically go into the infinity, but because the harmonics of a tone typically steadily fall in volume with increasing frequency, in practice, they peter out eventually. The character of a particular tone, often called its timbre or color, is partially determined by the relative volumes of the harmonics. These differences are a big part of what differentiates a clarinet from a violin, for instance. The hollow tone of a clarinet is partially due to a higher emphasis on the harmonics, while a violin tone gets its character for a more even distribution of harmonics across the frequency spectrum. So, for example, the bright tone of a trumpet is due to the high volume of its treble range upper harmonics, while the mellower tone of a French horn has much more sub-upper harmonics. So, tones are really the bread and butter of much music. All musical instruments, except for percussion instruments, primarily produce tones. Synthesizers also mostly produce tones. So right here I have a series of guitar riffs with distortion, with high gain distortion, and I wanted to check out the differences between the tones of this or the coloration of each timbre. Let's check it out, the first one. Let's check out another one. We'll be right back. So we listen here how each of them are very different in tone. It's because the distribution of harmonics of each individual riff, each individual type of distortion is distributed differently in the frequency spectrum. So it's very easy to for the ear to get used to one tone. And when you change to another tone drastically, you hear a very big difference between each one of them. So the equalization that we use on our amplifier, for example, is that what makes our tone. And also, well, there are a lot of other things that can lead to a tone. And so it's very easy for our ears to get used to a tone. But in mixing, it's easy to fall in a trap, because you think something sounds cool, but maybe your ear is get used to the sound, and when you put another a professional mix, you are going to hear what your mix is lacking about. So this is the topic of tones within the patterns of frequency distribution. The next topic here is the human voice. Okay, so the human voice produces tones, and thus could justifiably be lumped into the previous section. But there's a lot more to it than that. And since the human voice is such an important class of sound, central to so much music, it is worth examining more closely. The human voice can make a huge variety of sounds, but the most important sounds for music are those that are used in speech and singing, specifically vowels and consonants. Vowel is a tone. The specific vowel that is in tone is defined by the relative volumes of the different harmonics. The difference between an E and A is a matter of harmonic balance. In speech, vowel tones rarely stay on one pitch. They slide up and down. This is why speech does not sound tonal to us, though it technically is. Singing is conceptually the same as speaking, with the difference being that the vowels are heard loud at constant pitches. So we can see that the human voice, as it is used in speech and singing, is composed by two parts, tonal vowels and non-tonal consonants. That said, the human voice is very versatile, and many of its possible modes of expression are not covered by these two categories of sound. For example, whispering replaces the tonals of vowels with breathy, non-tonal noise, with consonants produced in the normal manner. Furthermore, many of the noises that are made, for instance, by beatboxers, defy analysis in terms of vowels and consonants. So I have here a recording of vocals. You can see singing is giving a speech, only with you are having different pitches. The vocals, you are giving certain pitch, so that's what makes different singing from speaking or talking. So let's check out this recording.
And in this death I tremble, my sin a perfect match for every scar. And in this death I remember the rebellion of my heart.
Okay, so there we have a recording of vocals. So next pattern of frequency distribution is drums. Drums, so far we have examined the tones and the human voice. The human voice is quite tonal in nature, so in a certain sense we're still looking at tones. Now we will look at drum sounds, which, though not technically are tones, they are still somewhat tonal in nature. A drum consists of a membrane of some sort stretched across a resonating body. It produces sound when the membrane is struck or hit. A drum produces a complex sound. The bulk of which resides in the bass and the lower mid-range. And this lower component of the sound, which I call the body, does not technically fit in the frequency arrangement of a tone, but usually bears a greater or lesser resemblance to such an arrangement, and thus the sound of a drum is somewhat tonal. In addition to the body component of the sound, which is created by the vibration of the membrane, part of the sound of a drum is created by the impact between the membrane and the striking object. This part of the sound, which I will refer to as the beater sound, has energy across the frequency spectrum, but is usually centered in the upper mid-range and the treble. Okay, so the drums are not like considered tones, but in somehow, some way, they have a certain pitch, and they have certain properties of a tone. So, for example, I have here Easy Drummer 2, and for example, listening to each of the drum kit. We can see that each tom is has a particularly pitch, different tone, speaking for itself. So so it is very common that for example this tom is higher, mid, low, and they are getting lower as you move on here, and the kick drum is the lowest pitch of the drum kit. So each of these sounds that the drum produce have certain tone, certain pitch. So that's why it is considered another pattern of frequency distribution. And the next pattern of frequency distribution is the cymbals. Having examined tones in general, the human voice and the drums, we come to the first and only completely non-tonal sound that we will examine, cymbals. Cymbals are thin metal plates that are struck like drums with beaters. The vibration of the struck plates create extremely complex patterns of frequencies, hence the non-tonal nature of cymbals. Cymbals have energy throughout the entire frequency spectrum, but the bulk of said energy is typically in the treble range or in the mid-range, in the case of large cymbals such as gongs. There is also reason to believe that cymbals have significant sonic energy above the range of human hearing, since their energy shows no signs of petering out near 20 kilohertz. In any case, because cymbals have so much treble energy, they are very exciting type of sound. So let's check out the cymbals. Okay, so the cymbals are located, well, I'm going to open up here the mixer and an equalizer. So right here we have the frequency spectrum, right? From 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. The cymbals are located right here. Some cymbals, like large cymbals, like I said, can be around here in all this spectrum. But most of the cymbals reside here in the treble and the higher mid-range. So these are considered a very energetic type of sound. It has a lot of crispness, a lot of bright to it. So we see how the drums cover a lot of frequency spectrum, since from the kick drum around here and the toms in all the frequency spectrum and the snare in the mid-range, but they are considered a really complex type of sound because they cover a lot of frequencies. So these are the four patterns of frequency distribution. I hope that it is useful to you. I hope that you learned something today. And stay with me for the next tutorials that I have prepared for you. And subscribe. And let me know in the comments if you have any doubts or questions. And so thank you very much for being in this tutorial with me. We are going to discuss some other theory topics, and then we move out to actually mixing. So thank you very much, folks. Have a great day or night, and we see you next time, all right?